Mark. Thank you for joining us today.
Hey, Trevor. Good to be here.
So we're going to be talking about transition today. In particular, I think it's worth starting off with a definition. So a lot of people will be familiar with green bonds or green financing, and that is financing that is specifically geared towards industries that are already green, for example, the offshore wind farm. Transition is really about reaching out to industries that are brown, that need to transition, but do not necessarily have any prospects of being green tomorrow. So we're talking about cement, we're talking about agriculture, and we're talking about mining in that sense. These are industries that do need to reduce their carbon footprint, but are not going to be green in that sense. So this is the idea that we're creating this new asset class, transition bonds, to really be able to allocate capital towards these companies lowering their carbon footprint.
Sure, and I think obviously what we're facing here is the biggest industrial challenge in human history. Okay, so we're going to have to mobilize finance in a way that's never really been done before. So that's the scale of the challenge we're facing here. So we absolutely do need to mobilize all financial asset classes and all sectors. Every sector has to play its part in the energy transition. So fully concur with what you're saying there.
I think the importance of transition as well helps to actually mitigate the risk of greenwashing. So we've seen in the news media several times, greenwashing is the idea that there is a green bond where the assets are not actually financing something that's going to be environmentally beneficial. Transition actually preserves the integrity of the green bond. But the important thing to remember with transition is you need some kind of science-based target or a metric there to actually identify how you're going to do that transition. The EU taxonomy is one positive step in that direction that has set out some very important science-based targets. For example, utilities generating no more than 100 grams of carbon per kilowatt hour of electricity generated. So it's important that if we don't have kind of a use of proceeds or a purely green industry, we need some other metric to measure this change.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we've now reached a point where the rubber is hitting the road, and we really need to be moving beyond grand statements and gestures and really doing things that align the most polluting sectors, all sectors ultimately, but the most polluting sectors initially, with a Paris-compliant trajectory.
On the corporate side, we're seeing more and more demand for the corporates to actually understand what their investors want at the end of the day. And the corporates are increasingly designing frameworks that are aligning to a 1.5-degree scenario or to the SDGs. So it's reassuring to actually see the corporates taking charge of their own destiny in this sense. This is something very much that we've seen is not a trend. This is a door that we've gone through that we're not going to kind of walk back through from now.
Yeah, I mean, I think I sometimes get that question, is this a trend? Or is it for real? And having lived through 10 years ago, the first wave of enthusiasm around carbon markets, carbon pricing, and I guess the early stages of what we now call sustainable investing, I think what's different now is what we were discussing just a few moments ago, which is the economics of the green economy have moved so far in the last 10 years that this is going to be structural. I mean, it's so much easier to have a conversation around green finance today because the economics are there. You can justify investing in renewable energy without subsidies. So that changes the dynamics of this completely. It really means that this is a structural change. It's not a passing fad or fashion. So I think the companies that are laggards on this are really going to face a very big problem the longer they leave it to start thinking seriously about these issues.
Absolutely. I think the decade from 2020 to 2030 is going to be the decade of transition now, and that's really what we're going to see is more and more momentum about companies understanding how they can, even if they're from brown industries, moving to be less brown and then hopefully green sometime in the future.
Yeah, indeed. And again, it's all about this feedback loop, because the policy pressure will only increase from here. That's why I don't think you can afford, as an investor, as a corporate, as a policymaker, any longer to sit on the sidelines and wait to see. You've got to be active, and you've got to be proactive, and you've got to be, to use the phrase that we use on the asset management side, you've got to be a future maker rather than a future taker.
And I think even in terms of trade relations in the future, all of these elements are going to start to play into that. We don't necessarily see it today, but certainly in the future, if you're not aligned to a Paris Accord, trade deals are going to become more difficult for countries that aren't necessarily aligned to a Paris Accord agreement.
I think that's absolutely right. You know, I mean, we're entering the era of climate diplomacy. This is going to be a phrase we hear a lot more of going forward. And I think another phrase we're going to hear an awful lot about is the social license to operate. You know, it's been used within the context of the fossil fuel industry now for some time, but there are some of these other industries that have very intensive environmental footprints in other areas. If you think of the textile industry or the clothing industry, the water footprint is horrendous on that industry. I think that's going to be a big area of focus.
Well, Mark, it sounds like we have a lot of good work to do out there. So thank you very much for your time today and for being with us.
It's been a pleasure, Trevor. Great catching up, and we should do this more often.
Indeed. Thank you.